Good afternoon, everyone. I will just very briefly run through the management of alcohol withdrawal syndrome. Pratima has already spoken about the signs and symptoms. I had kept a few slides with regards to that, so I'm going to just run through that and we'll move straight ahead with evaluation and management. So just to start off, the majority of patients who present with alcohol withdrawal, as Professor Pratima has already mentioned, can be managed very comfortably in an outpatient setting. Inpatient management will be required for these kinds of cases. Individuals with severe withdrawal symptoms, people with confusion or delirium, when there is a presence of a comorbid medical or surgical illness, and as some of you have already mentioned, when there are concurrent psychiatric symptoms of an acute nature, which would include either mood or perceptual disturbances or else suicidality, as well as certain special populations like pregnancy might require inpatient care if the person presents in the context of alcohol withdrawal. Now, in the current context, what we need to be most concerned about is severe withdrawal symptoms, confusion and delirium, and the presence of a comorbid medical or surgical illness. Now, there are certain risk factors which are there for the development of complicated withdrawal, and these have been covered to some extent. Just to reiterate, I think it's very, very important that you need to ask about when the last use of the alcohol was, or when the reduction in the use of alcohol was noted to be present, whether there is a past history of complicated withdrawal syndrome, and a general idea about how much alcohol is being used, because heavy use of alcohol is very commonly associated with complicated withdrawal. In addition to that, please make sure you keep in mind that people who are slightly older are at higher risk for developing complicated withdrawal. In addition to that, the presence of a comorbid medical illness might also be a risk factor for complicated withdrawal. So as I had mentioned, these are the points which need to be covered in the history. Please conduct a thorough physical examination and a neurological examination for all your patients. I need not mention this to you because you will all be doing this and probably would be very adept at doing this, more so than probably some of us. But just the points that need to be mentioned and the points that need to be kept in mind. Hydration is something which needs to be checked. The presence of the general pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy, and pedal edema, presence of external injuries, hepatosplenomegaly, and signs of liver cell failure, focal neurological deficits, because very often, people can present with head injury and focal neurological deficits, or a CVA and focal neurological deficits, even in the context of alcohol withdrawal. The other thing that one needs to evaluate, if it is possible, is meningeal signs, because again, the presence of a comorbid meningitis or encephalitis is also something which we see very often in individuals with alcohol withdrawal. Another point which I have not mentioned here, which you guys need to kind of be very clear about, is a respiratory system examination, because very commonly aspiration and pneumonia symptoms, particularly in the current context, are very common with alcohol withdrawal, in patients with alcohol withdrawal. These are the bare minimum investigations that we would recommend that be ordered for these patients. And in most cases, these are sufficient to be able to manage an individual with alcohol withdrawal. So a random blood sugar, a liver function test, a renal function test, and serum electrolytes, hematology, an ECG definitely needs to be done, because there are a high risk of cardiac arrhythmias occurring in individuals, particularly above the age of 40 years. But if there are other high risk conditions, it's better to get an ECG done. A chest X-ray, as I had mentioned, because this population, particularly with complicated withdrawal, have an increased risk of aspiration and increased risk of developing pneumonia. If there is delirium or seizures and you're suspecting other CNS causes, a CT brain with contrast might also be indicated. Now, as I had mentioned, there are various scales that are used for assessing withdrawal. We will share the SIVA AR with you. This is the SIVA AR. I think Professor Prabhat has already shared it with you. A score of less than 10 on the SIVA AR constitutes mild withdrawal, 11 to 15 constitutes moderate withdrawal, and more than 15 constitutes severe withdrawal. Now, with regards to uncomplicated withdrawal, the symptoms of which have already been covered in the previous presentations, there are general measures and specific measures which one needs to take. Ensure an adequate diet, correct dehydration and electrolyte disturbances. And generally, for individuals who have uncomplicated withdrawal, either thiamine 100 mg or a multivitamin which contains multiple B complex vitamins, but definitely thiamine also, should be given intramuscularly for 7 days, once a day, followed by oral supplementation of 2 to 3 tablets of a multivitamin for 3 months. In addition to this, proton pump inhibitors can be used for 7 to 10 days. These are general measures that can be used in individuals with uncomplicated withdrawal. Specific measures, as mentioned and as has been pointed out in the quiz, the treatment of choice, and that is what I'm going to be talking about today, is benzodiazepines. And the ones that are most commonly used are either diazepam or lorazepam. So in individuals who present with uncomplicated withdrawal, you can keep a dose of between 40 to 60 milligrams in divided doses, which can be tapered over a period of 7 to 10 days at around 5 to 10 milligrams every 2 days. Similarly, if you are suspecting that this person has hepatic compromise, then you can use tablet lorazepam, 8 to 12 milligrams in divided doses. Please bear in mind that in lorazepam, at least initially when you're starting the doses, you would have to dose it QID, whereas diazepam can be dosed TID. Lorazepam should be dosed QID and then tapered over 7 to 10 days, similar to diazepam. So this is an example of a tapering regimen. It's a very simple, I mean, this is something which can be done for most people with uncomplicated withdrawal. And if we give this kind of a tapering regimen, a majority of individuals will not actually go on to develop complicated withdrawal. Now, there are a few advices or precautions which need to be given when you're making these prescriptions. One is, of course, advice not to drive vehicles, work at heights, or operate heavy machinery. In addition to that, there should not be a combination of benzodiazepines and alcohol used concomitantly. In addition to that, if the person, you have to also advise the patient that if there is excessive drowsiness or if the person is falling down, then the person has to stop the medications. In case the person goes on to develop complicated withdrawal, you need to advise the individual that he needs to report back to you or report to the hospital. So if he develops seizures or becomes confused or agitated despite the treatment. Now, with regards to complicated withdrawal, as Professor Pratima had already mentioned, these constitute mainly seizures as well as delirium tremens. The general measures and that are used for treatment of complicated withdrawal are largely the same. Generally, what we advise is keep the person nil peroral if the person is confused or an altered sensorium, because there is a high risk of aspiration that is there in these individuals. If it is possible, do input-output monitoring to ensure that there is adequate input and there's adequate urine output. In addition to that, monitor vitals frequently. Now, this depends on the amount of support and the intensity by which you can actually monitor. Ideally, and I will be talking about the ideal treatment protocols as well as some of the other treatment protocols when we do not have ideal settings. In complicated withdrawal, it's generally preferable to monitor vitals at least once in an hour and a minimum of once in 2 hours. In addition to this, make sure that you maintain the airway and you secure an IV access. As I'd mentioned, check the hydration status and replace with IV fluids. Generally, you can use fluids like normal saline as well as ringer lactate. If you are suspecting intracellular dehydration, you can also use hypotonic fluids like half normal saline or 5% dextrose. Also correct electrolyte abnormalities either orally or intravenously if required. High dose multivitamin supplementation, and this is a point I want to just spend about 30 seconds on, is extremely important in individuals with complicated withdrawal, because these individuals are at a high risk for developing neurological complications related to vitamin deficiencies, specifically Wernicke's encephalopathy. And so it is extremely important that you use a multivitamin supplementation which has multiple B-complex vitamins, so something like Optineuron or Neurobion, and use it at high doses, that is 15 ampules in 500 ml of NS, which can be given over 4 hours, once a day for 7 days. So that is, on an average, you're giving 1500 mg of thiamine and the other B-complex vitamins that are there in these standard formulations. In addition to this, make sure that you give proton pump inhibitors as well as anti-aspiration measures. Now, with regards to acute control of seizures, for management of complicated withdrawal and alcohol withdrawal seizures, the treatment of choice again is benzodiazepines. You can give IV diazepam 5 to 10 milligrams or IV lorazepam 2 to 4 milligrams IV slow and repeat if necessary at 10 to 15 minute intervals. You have to be very cautious about monitoring for the development of delirium tremens in individuals who have seizures because they are at a greater risk for developing delirium tremens. Now, with regards to delirium tremens, there are two ways in which it can be managed. Ideally, it should be managed in an ICU setup with cardiorespiratory monitoring. And diazepam 5 to 10 mg IV needs to be given every 10 minutes up to 1 hour. And IV lorazepam 2 to 4 mg can be given every 15 minutes. And the end point of giving this treatment is achieving mild sedation. Now, if there is failure to achieve mild sedation with a certain dose, that is 50 milligrams of diazepam or 10 milligrams of lorazepam within 1 hour, it is considered to be refractory delirium tremens and it needs to be referred to an intensive care unit. If mild sedation is achieved, repeat doses of oral or IV diazepam can be used every 4 hours to maintain the mild sedation for the next 5 to 7 days. Now, in practical settings where we do not have all the ideal settings to manage their uncomplicated cases with complicated, I mean, as long as delirium tremens is not complicated by other medical comorbidities, it is not resistant to benzodiazepine treatment, you can use some of these treatment protocols. If the LFT is normal with vitals monitoring hourly, you can give tablet diazepam 10 mg orally till the patient is sedated and his pulse rate is less than 100 per minute. Often there might be an average dose of almost between 100 to 200 milligrams, which may be required in some cases. The total dose that is required on day one is then given in divided doses from day two and tapered over 7 to 10 days. Similarly, if the person has a deranged LFT with AST and ALT more than 3 times the normal values, lorazepam can be used, again 2 mg hourly. Average doses of 16 to 24 hours may be required in some cases. And similarly, you can taper the doses over 7 to 10 days. These are some of the precautions or advice that you need to take when you're managing complicated withdrawal. Do not repeat doses of diazepam or lorazepam if the person is heavily sedated, not arousable or comatose. And although there is a practice generally to use antipsychotics to also tranquilize individuals with delirium tremens, it is generally best avoided because it's quite possible that these people who are already at a risk for arrhythmia might actually develop an arrhythmia and then subsequently after that might actually have a sudden cardiac death. It is something that we have seen. If you are using antipsychotics if you are mandated and you want to use antipsychotics, please at least document that you have an ECG and the QTC interval is not prolonged. So if the QTC interval is not prolonged, you may cautiously consider using antipsychotics such as haloperidol in these cases. These are red flags where there should be a plan to refer. If there are refractory seizures, if there is delirium persisting even after treatment with the benzodiazepines that have been instructed, or if there is a presence of uncontrolled medical comorbidity such as head injury, diabetic ketoacidosis, or hepatic encephalopathy, it's probably better to refer to an intensive care unit. So this is my conclusion. Most cases of alcohol withdrawal syndrome can be managed by the physicians. Prompt identification and management can lead to a significant reduction in morbidity and mortality. Benzodiazepines are the treatment of choice and they should be used in adequate doses. And high dose multivitamin supplementation is mandatory for all cases of complicated alcohol withdrawal syndrome. Thank you.